Okay. Am I recording? Yeah. Indexing. Okay, so today we'll finish the rest of the pandas slides. Okay, so first thing I'll talk about is the missing data handling. Start there. Okay, so having missing data is something that you all have learned a bit when you use the NumPy function. Like gen from text, load text. Okay, so when you handle missing data, often or not, example of missing data is this case. So this is a CSV format, right? Oh, so obviously, so there's three columns here, and sometimes you may have like perfectly nice three set of values, but other rows you might have a missing value like this. So missing values come in many forms. Sometimes they're just empty, or sometimes they can be replaced by non-valid values and such. So it's important to know how to handle the missing values. Out of the box, pandas gives you some ability to fill in the missing values or to drop the rows that you have missing values for. Okay. So here are a few functions that help you to check for missing values or NaN. NaN basically means not a number. That's what it stands for. So we see an NaN, which is very common in most programming languages. So if you try to print a value and it tells you NaN, that means if you're trying to do something, you're trying to tell the program code that is a number, but then it tells you that it's not a number, so it gives you NaN, right? So the functions here available like is now, not now. For the data frame, it has a function called drop Na and fill Na. Okay, so this is a few basic functions for handling missing data. So take note, this is missing data, not wrong data format. So if you have a situation whereby you expect column A to be numbers and suddenly an alphabet appears out of nowhere, right? This is not handling missing data. This is more like handling mal format data. So we'll maybe work on that. I think somewhere down the line I'll show you, talk about how to handle that kind of stuff. But here will be missing. So missing basically is not that. So jump straight to the code. Now, if you try to do something like re-indexing, which is one of the earlier slides. So re-indexing is when you introduce new indexes. So in example, in this case, the first table here has three rows. So when these three rows was created, the index A, B, and C were created. Now, if you try to re-index with that has a size greater than the previous index size, which is I now introduce an index called D. So naturally, that row has no values for all the columns. The result will give you NaN. Now, why is it NaN in this case? Because in the initial data, the initial table on the left-hand side, the data frame already decided that the data type for all this is a kind of float. So if you introduce a new row with no values, right, it's sort of null, the panel panel pattern, we should set it to an NAN, not a number. Okay, so this is the result. So in reindexing can actually cause missing data. In this case, it's called missing data. Now, if I say these values are all string, okay, so what you get here would basically be a null value instead, or empty, or should be a null value, not just empty string. Okay. So a bit more definition on values that are considered missing. NAN, we call it the default missing value marker for reasons of computational speed. Okay, so if you're handling numbers, typically you get an NAN. Okay, sometimes the none will come out also. Okay, so we're gonna try to use some of the functions available to us in pandas, like it's now and not now. So assuming this is my data set, okay, three columns and there are some missing values along the way, right? So you can obviously see some missing, some pockets of missing information. Okay, so if I try to do a load here, so let me load the data frame. So this is my NA CSV lah. So when you load the data frame that has missing values, in this case, there are values that don't exist in the CSV file, then you get NAN there. You notice all the NAN actually stands for actually missing values there. So what we're going to do is, how do you like clear all this data? So one strategy of clearing the missing data often would be like, do you delete the whole row that has an NAN there, or do you replace it with something else? Okay, so the two strategies of replacing or deleting a row actually impacts your data analysis. Sometimes the column can just be replaced by an arbitrary value, okay, which doesn't affect your analysis. But sometimes because it's NAN, it affects everything else, maybe it's better to just drop it. But the first step before that is to find out how do you find out if there are any null values at all. Because often or not, when we receive the data, it won't be so small like this guy. Six rows of data only. If you're going to process data, it will come in hundreds, thousands, or tens of thousands. So there's no way you're going to visually look at it. So you need an efficient way to find those null values. So in here, there is a function from PD. So from PD means it's a pandas function, not from data frame function. Okay, it's called is now. So what happened is this example here, I'm trying to check if the waiting column has null values or not. Okay, so I'm going to demonstrate on my own data code here. So I'm going to print pd.isNow. So I'm going to find out which column has data. Because this is not a very good way of finding out the null column data manually going column by column like this. Okay. So, but we want to look at what's the output of doing a isNow. So when you run a isNow function on one column, you get this Boolean index. Does it look like a Boolean index that you apply? You can apply to your regular n-dimensional array. So basically anything that is null will be flagged as true. So let me print. So if I print the data frame and then print out. So basically column A, index 1 is null, index 2 is null, index 4 is null, and index 5 is null. Okay, so if you would apply this as a Boolean index on your column A, okay, you will get back all the null values. Okay, so you shouldn't use this as a Boolean index to filter away the null values. If you want to filter away the null values, you should use the inverse of the reverse of the method is null, rather call the other method is called not null. So I'm going to change this is now to not now and see and look at the result. So in this case, when I do a not now, my result or my Boolean index actually changes. All the values that are true refer to values in my column A that are not a missing value. So now perhaps I can use this as a kind of Boolean index to filter my rows, to only pick out the rows that have values in all in column A. Okay. Then again, if you do investigation of a large data set, like a thousand, few thousand of rows, this also is not a very smart way, because you need to look at all the true and false, right? So what you can do to, let's say, if you want to find out if a data set has null values, instead of printing out this and looking at it, since this p is not null, will give, or is null, let's put is null, gives me a kind of a data frame, right? Let me first. Thing is to this. I'm trying to find out if I can do that. Check the signs. Let's see. Language. Okay, wait. Okay. You haven't teached that one yet. Yeah, I thought I could do query. This is not in the slide, query method. I don't think it's a data frame. Okay, I just throw something not in the slide. Okay, so this is how I might want to find out if there are null values in my data set for one of the columns. So after doing the is null, I get a data frame back. First you put in the data frame instance, then I can do a query or simply one of the ways you can query your n-dimensional array to find out whether there are any true values inside. Then look at the size. So this will tell me really are there any like null values in this particular column, but it's just only one column. Okay. So what if your strategy to dealing with missing values was to drop them? Okay. So what we can check is now, can we like drop off data that doesn't, that's not valid? So comes a method called drop NA. So notice this table that is from a kidney disease database. You have some NAN values, not number values. Okay. So I'm gonna try to just drop. So say all this fancy query checking, I don't wanna care about it, right? So maybe I'll do drop NA. Read the CSV file. Okay, sorry. Drop NA will return you a filtered data. Okay. So if you can see what happened if you do a drop NA, after you drop NA, you must actually return back. You will assign back your new data frame. So the new data frame, then you use a new data frame here. So after I drop NA, I return it to DF2. DF2 will contain all the rows that don't have a null values. So this drop NA basically does a sweep through your data frame and check if the row has one null, not any NAN value or missing value, it will just remove that row. So when I had previously 6 rows of data, because I have four of them which are which contain some missing values, after I drop any, I only left with two rows. So if your strategy was simply to just clear off the null values, this is a quick and easy way to do it. Okay. Let me take a look at drop any. So I'm just curious to find out what else does drop, what else can I do in drop NA? So drop NA has some interesting options, including axis. Do I want to drop by determine if rows or columns contain are removed? Okay. So drop NA can be used in a little more dumb way. Okay, with all these options here. How is any? So they have options here like if there is one any value in a row, it drops the entire row or column. Okay, or the option is that all the values at any drop the entire row or column. Okay, so drop any has additional options you can use depending on the situation. Right. Okay, so in place, what does in place means is that when you do in place means you modify the original data frame. If I use in place, okay, so this is what I understand. In place, so if I do in place equals to true, my original DF would change. Okay. But by default it is false. So your original data shouldn't change, but your returns result from drop any would be the final data, filtered data. Okay, so next we fill into the second strategy of handling missing values is to do a fill. Okay, so like your gen from text and load text, right, there is you always have this option of filling missing values. If let's say it matches NA or empty string or something like that, you decide what kind of value to fill based on the column. Okay, so pandas also allow you to do certain things like this. So there's a fill NA function. There are three ways to do it. Okay, one is a scalar, one is backwards and forwards and backwards. Show you later with some example what I mean by that. So if generally you say just fill NA, like this case, so you just change everything that has an NAN to a zero value here. Okay, so we're going to go back to my example. Let me pick away this cell. So my DF obviously has some missing values, but my strategy is not to delete them, I want to replace them. So what happened is, I can do here too. I think it's to do, So df.fill na, in this case I do a 0, then I print my diaframe 2 out. So notice now that all the previous na values which is here are changed to 0 after the do fill na. Now, if you any is coming from data frame, you can also have the in place option to say you want to modify the original data frame, or by default, it will return you the data frame with the filled values. Okay, so this is a very straightforward method. So you can choose to fill the values with either numbers or text, depending on what is the arbitrary value, default value you want to give the column. So in the option of fill any, they also have this thing called forward and backwards. Now, filling gets forward method where you specify a parameter called method with different values to put in. So what does it mean by forward and backward? So look at these two tables in blue and yellow. So the blue table is the original one. The yellow is after it has applied the method for fill with method pad. So this is going forward. Okay, so if you look at RBC, which is the column with the missing values, After you apply the function called fill NA method pad, okay, strangely the first two missing values are still there. Okay, but the last one is removed. Anything after the it seems to follow the rule that anything after the last missing value is all filled up. So that's so called feeling it forward. What about bad words? So to do a bad word, you still use fill NA, but for the method, you put in a value called B fill. I think there's a typo here lah. It should be backwards already. Okay. So we look at the table again. So originally look at row index 0, row index 1, and row index 5. Now when you do a fill backward, what happened is it seems that it's time to fill everything up. Okay. Not a very good example to show you what exactly is going on, right? Okay, so I will use my own example here. So my table here is like a Swiss cheese, a lot of holes inside. So I'm gonna just do a fill forward and backward and see what happens. Okay, so I'm gonna fill with 0. Method is pack. So this is the first example, right? Okay. Okay, so this is my original data. Maybe I should print the original data side by side or top and bottom. Let's do this, easier to see. Okay, this is my original table. Look at all the NaN values. So I have like a pocket here and a pocket here. Now when I do a method pad, so this is going forward. What are the values of my NaN now? So these two NaN values follow the previous NaN value. These two NaN values follow the previous NaN value. Okay, do you see a pattern? So when you say forward means, right, the moment I encounter a not missing value, right, I'll take the previous value and copy over. That's the meaning of forward. So now I'm going to modify my data. I'm going to put 7 here. 0, 0. Save this guy. So I'm going to go downwards. Okay, now I'm going to do the B fill, which is the backwards thing, right? Let me load the data first. Okay, and do a B fill. Okay, so my original data looks like this. Okay, now I'm filling backwards. So when I fill backwards B fill, what happens is that when I encounter a missing value here, I take the next available value and fill it and copy it to the previous one. So where this is a 6, right? 1 and 2 becomes the same value as this guy. So this is backwards. Now the last two values here, which are not a number, it becomes 7. So it's as if it's running it's doing this loop from the last row to the first row. And then the moment it encounters, oh, this is not a number, a missing value at the end. Let me copy from the previous row, 7. Then after that, is NaN copy from 7 again? Then 6, okay, nothing. Now it's NaN copy from 6. Then is NaN copy from 6 again here? So this is backwards. Okay. Why do we do this? Sorry, I can't give you an answer now. I can't think of a good example why I want to propagate values forward and backward like that yet. Okay, but if you do come from a situation, yeah, this you can even conveniently copy values from a previous row or the previous row or the row before or after. Okay. So they also have another version of the fill NA, where you can fill it with a value you specify request scalar, which is any value you want. You can fill it forwards by carrying forward a value from previous cell, backwards from a next cell. Now you have a mean value. Okay. Actually, this fill NA mean, right, is very much the same as, this is no difference from the original fill NA with a 0 there. The only difference is that the fill NA with a mean basically just calls out a mean from the data frame. Okay, so replace NA with the mean of the values of the column. So whatever is an NA, you replace with a mean. What does it mean that way? Okay, so look at this table. So in this case, if you're talking about mean values, means that your missing values has to be a number. Example in here, RC. So RC column, most of them are numbers. Except, so if you don't look at the NaN, the rest of the values in RC column are all numbers. So what happens is that you fill the missing values here with the mean values from this RC column. So it calculates the mean value and puts it inside. So why is the mean value important or significant? So you know, if you do your statistics, mean value is like the average, right? Okay. So now that your missing rows, because you still want to take into account your missing rows, but you cannot give them a zero, because zero is too, can be too low, or cannot give them a too high a number, so you give them something in between. So in any case, if you have to calculate a mean or could do a standard deviation for this RC column, it's not so much affected by the missing values here, because you preset them with all a mean value. So it helps in your analysis later for RC by setting a mean value there. If your strategy was to drop off all the NaN values, right, it might adversely affect your data analysis later because you actually reduce your sample size. So it's not too bad if you put a mean value there, at least. Now the mean value doesn't work for text columns like RBC here. So RBC has typical values like a normal and suddenly has an NaN, which is a missing value. Your mean doesn't work because mean only works for numbers. So if you do if you fill NA with mean, you'll notice you still have gaps in the columns that you that are string or text kind of data type. So for those data types that are text, maybe it's not that important to fill in the missing values, because those with text could be like a kind of category or classification data rather than the value that you use to calculate statistics. So in a way, it can be a bit forgiving. So these are the few methods for filling missing values. Okay. But generally, it's a bit it's kind of different from your NumPy, where you can specify replacement based on a matching text. So you might ask, so how do I do the NumPy stuff that I used to do, but I can't do in pandas because it doesn't show up there? So. Pandas data system. I'm going to just Google this. Okay, actually, a better way is to look at the documentation. So I'm taking from NumPy example, when I run a load text, gen from text, there are these options that help me specify missing values or replacement values or fill values. So if there's something that exists in NumPy, then I'm thinking when you read CSV, so this kind of similar option should also exist. So we should look at read CSV options, which is like a lot, right? Okay, so let me just skip to the very important one I want to look at. So far, you're familiar with, we'll look at separator, okay, header, maybe header, index column. Okay, so I'm going to look for something called NA values. So this NA value option actually allows you, so it accepts a scalar, string, a list, or dictionary. So this is very similar in your load or gen from text, where you specify if this early value appears, then I will recognize it as an NA value. Okay. So by default, the following values are recognized as a NaN, not a number or for communication purposes. So if your data set contains a hex n-a, a null, a NA, okay, or any of this format here in your Excel or CSV file, it will automatically be recognized as a NaN value, missing value. Okay, so sometimes if you're gonna do your CA1 and you come across values like that, right, and you wonder where the NaN value come from, this is part of the reason why. So the original data has a N/A, which is typical for saying not applicable. Yeah, it will be recognized as a missing value. Now you can also use any value to specify other formats of edit of missing value. So then not so you don't confuse your data set the string values with something that is actually missing. So if you know that data set uses some special format to say this is a missing value, like maybe they just put a dash, a hyphen, right, in the column. Okay. So say example here, right, instead of doing an empty string, I put this kind of things. So if I count this kind of stuff, right, it's not good for me because if I try to read a CSV, because of this, pandas would think that column A is a string. But whereas maybe it's intended to be a number, okay, then I can specify if I read CSV, say, hey, anything that looks like this, right, is an NaN. So that will be specified under this NA values. So now as I go through the rest of the parameters, do I see anything that help me fill up missing values or what? Okay. So unfortunately they don't really have anything that helps me to like do some of the things that I have in NumPy. NA filter, interesting. So if you decided that anything at NA will be filtered out, right, you can use this option to filter out detect missing value markers in data parsing. Okay. Delete missing value markers. This will delete the missing values. Keep it for NA, true. Okay, looks like I still have to use the drop NA manually. Okay, so how do we handle other values? So you only have a few NA to replace any not a number values to a value that you want to use. So roughly that's the most you can do. Okay, so now I'm going to go forward. To this, combining data sets. Okay, so combined data sets is useful when you have things like this. So look at this three data set here. So this looks like the student's register. Another one. Okay, probably these two we can concat. Okay, and then you have another data file that contains subject ID with the test ID. Okay, so apparently there's some kind of relations or some kind of way of joining these two together, maybe. So how do you do the joining of data sets together? So we use this merge function in pandas. So these are a few functions available for merge. Typically, when you merge, you need to have a minimum one matching column of some sort. Okay. So some of you in CA1, you all like have try to do a scatter plot, then you have two different data sets but matching years. So in pandas, you can actually do a merge together in that case. Okay. So here are some of the methods. We'll go through one by one. Okay. So the first one we'll try out is the merge with the option how equal left. So we're gonna try this example. Let's see. Can you download the data? Let me see if I can use any data here to do this. So in doing merge, what you're looking at, what is the situation to use it, is where you have two different data sets, but with a common column. So in this case here, the example, you have two data sets, but the customer ID is a common so-called column inside. So we've given a common column, what you will merge, you merge by the value for each row. So in your example, if you downloaded the data sets used, right? Not sure we can find something here to do the merge. But in the the slides gives you something else. Okay. So the base steps is to read your two CSV files or Excel files, and then you do a merge. So the merge accepts a few parameters. First, the first two parameters will be the two data frames you want to merge. Now the how parameter specifies which side of the data you want to merge on. What do I mean by which side? So if you look at these two data sets, so this is DF1 and this is DF2. Okay, merge data set CSV. We have or not merge data sets in. Really not here. Okay, never mind. Different. Yeah. So the slides and the data here is different. But I mean, I can play around with it. Yeah. I can actually do. I can play around with this one. Okay. So. Okay. So if you look at, actually you can use this as an example, technically you can, but you get some, depending on how you do it, you get some interesting results. So let's say I'm going to merge, right, this one, data set, this data set here, I'm going to merge it, not with this guy, because I want to merge with another set with different columns, so I'll merge with this. The common denominator, the common column here will be subject ID. Okay, so this is subject ID, and this has subject ID too, right? So technically, I can use this example much. So let's try. So of course, df merge one is equals to. So let me read the data first. So the other data is this one, number 3. So df merge. So when I do this, df, so I'm gonna merge df merge 1, df merge 2. Okay, so first of all, it's how. How, when I say left, right. So how means basically how is the data merged on the direction of the table. Okay, and then followed by the common denominator, which is the column. So to specify the column that I wanna merge on, you say on. Use the on parameter. Now the on parameter is something similar to databases when you do a join. You often say join on what columns. Okay. So I'm gonna show you data. Okay. So what happened here? So this is the merge data as a result. So I want you to pay attention to the column, the order of the columns. Subject ID, first name, last name, test ID. Okay. So subject ID, first name, last name. This is the first DF, DF merge one. So imagine this is on the left hand side. Okay. I merge with number 2. Number 2 is this data that has test ID. This on the right hand side. So the result is my DF1 is actually the first 3 columns, my DF2 is appended on the right hand side, this column here. I'm gonna change this to right. See what happens. Okay. Maybe I should do one DF merge left. One example is much right. Okay, what does right and left mean? Okay. So this is merge on left on subject ID. This is merge on right by subject ID. So the common denominator is still subject ID, but why does DF2, the second, the merge on right, has more rows than the first one? Okay, so if this is my left and this is my right, okay, so when I say left right means I take the left one as my primary table. Everything is based on that table. Meaning to say, whatever is here, the rows here, right, will be, how do I describe it? I should say the final merge output will never be more than the number of rows in the left table. So if this table has 5 rows of data, even though my right hand side has 11 or 99 rows of data, right, it will never be more than 5. Because it's based on this as a primary table to merge. Means when I match the values, I only match what is available in the left table. Okay, that's what I mean by how. Okay. Now the other one which I did a merge right, I merge by the right table, means I take the DF2 as my primary table. That means for every row in the in on the right table, I must find the matching value from my left table. And if there is no matching value, pandas will fill it with any end. So that's between my left and right. So left and right meaning which one here, left or right, is the primary table to match, to merge by. Any question? So when you merge table, right? Cannot say by right lah. So by usually by left lah. Maybe if you're right-handed, you always think the left-hand side is the primary one all the time. Then you're right-handed, you think the left-hand side is okay, I mean, that's nonsense. So if your habit is your habit, right? So it's a bit of habitual thing. If your habit is always the left is the primary right, then you normally use how is left. Then whatever on the right hand side will just merge according to whatever on the right here will merge based on what you have on the left. So everything take reference from here. So when you say right means everything take reference from here. Okay? So that's why in these two examples, you see one has only 5 rows, the other has like 10 rows there. So this is your merge left-right. It's a bit similar to SQL where we have this thing called joining of tables. Left join, right join. Okay. So now we're going to try another option of merge called inner. Okay. This is also like SQL. We also happen to have so this concept of joining tables in SQL, which we'll cover next week. Okay. So when you join tables, here you call merge. In SQL, you call it join. So you've done databases, you have left join, right join, inner join. So this is also similar. Now there's an inner merge or inner join. Okay. So we're going to do an inner and see what happens. So if I take the same data, okay, now I'm going to create one more. So merge. Inner. And run it. Okay, so for merge inner, what happens? Your result is you have 5 rows only. Let me modify the data a little bit. No, there's no difference from the first example, right? This one here, and this one here. Okay, so let me modify it to give you a better illustration. So this is my first data, subject ID 11. So what I'm trying to do is to introduce some more subject IDs that don't exist in the other set, in this other data here. Save this. Come back here, read the data and merge it. See if I get anything. Okay, so now I got 3 different examples. So my data set now has changed. What happened is that on this has a set of subject IDs, okay, 1 to 11. Now the other data set I have also has subject IDs, but it has three subject IDs that don't exist in the other data set, child 13, 14. So I come back, rewind back to the merge left, merge right. So when I do a merge left based on this, okay, because I put this as my first parameter, okay, merge left. So for every row here, I will find from this table, this data frame, a matching subject ID, and then append it, append the column, okay. So one has a matching, okay. For better explanation, I will split the window into two sides so you can see it. Okay, so left and right, sorry, maybe I should switch the side. Left and right. So left table, right table. I'm going to do merge. How much by left side? So meaning on the left table, one right but matches the one on the right hand side, or subject ID. So every subject ID will match. So one will find its match until 14. Oh no, in fact until 12, 13, and 14. Problem is 12, 13, 14 on the right table, it doesn't exist. So you say merge left, 12, 13, 14 will come out in the final data frame, but will have any n missing values. So this is merge left. Now if I do merge right, okay, short space. Now I merge by the left side table. So every subject ID I will fill up with something from the right hand side. If it doesn't exist, I'll put a missing value inside. Okay? So I get 1 to 11. That's the merge. That's my merge left if I use that. Sorry, I think I confused myself a bit.
Merge left means this is the primary and match by that. Merge right means this is the primary and match by now I do merge inner. So merge inner means,
or I should look at the data. This is my merge inner. Do you notice that? So yes, ID, subject ID 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, so let me come back to my left right example.
Okay, so merge inner doesn't care about whether this is a primary table on the left or the right hand table, they are with the primary table. If I say it's a set A, set B, what is the intersection? So you understand the intersection, right? Makes sense. So anything that's common, you will merge. Anything that will result in a missing value, you will not merge. So 1 is common, 2 is common, 3 is common, 4 is common, 5 is common. 7 to 11 doesn't exist then. 12, 14, doesn't exist here, so it's the intersection. So that's what I mean by inner. I change the data. So if your left is a subset of your right, given you put inner right, your inner will be the same result as your subset. If your right is a subset of your left, you do an inner, your middle will be the right side. Not most likely, basically just think of intersection. What's the overlapping between these two data sets based on the condition which the call is specified from the subject ID. So where two of these data frames have the same subject ID, that is a result data frame from a merge inner.
So therefore the data here will exist only have these few subject IDs. So this is your merge inner. So merge inner is useful especially when you want to maintain some sort of data integrity based on the common column. Okay, that means you cannot tolerate right not missing values for the other table. So you normally do a merge inner. Okay, so next kind of merging function is called the isIn. Actually more like a query, sounds more like a query, like a question, right? Is this in that table? Okay, so how does it work? DF1. Okay, so if you look at the syntax, right, notice that is the data frame you actually pass the result of its in into a data frame, which is similar to what you do when you're doing Boolean indexing, right? So only when you pass something like this with a Boolean index, then you can filter out the values. So I'm going to try this on my subjects. So if I'm going to, so let's say I take my first data, my merge one, right, and try to find out if, here's an example, in merge one, the subject ID is in the other subject ID. Okay, so how do you use this is in? You use it, you call is in after the column name. So you know in data frames, like if you read a CSV, every column actually becomes a directly referenced property. So you can actually call out the column property by doing a dot, therefore by the name of the column. In this case, subject ID. So I'm interested to find out whether my this data set, which is one, the subject ID is here. I'm interested to find out in the subject IDs here exist inside this data set based on the subject ID. So I'll say df1 dot subject ID, is it in my df mesh 2? Of course, if I want to find out, is it in my must specify the column or the column here. So something like that. Okay. So what happened here is the result of the is in is like a query gives me the intersection between this data set based on subject ID and this data set. Okay, so the is in is almost acting like a inner merge. Similar. Okay. What is going on? So if you extract this part of the is in, right, because here you're actually applying a Boolean index. Let me just remove that and print out what's the result function of calling this is in. Okay. So this is a Boolean index. So when you learn it earlier on, right, with list, right, you can apply a Boolean index to filter a list. You can also apply a Boolean index here to filter your data frame. So when it's in, actually merely just gives you a Boolean index of matching two columns together. So here's the next interesting is in, but it has we call this a tilde. The tilde is the curly thing below your escape button on top of the tab or keyboard. Okay. Special notation, it has to be done before the. So instead of after dot, you still do is in, but you do this special symbol before the data frame here. So what exactly is this doing? Now if I come to, so this is my original set, right? I'm going to print out an example like this. Let's see if this works or not. May not work. Oh, actually works. Okay, so can you see something here? So the first one I'm doing a is in, okay, this Boolean index. Then the second Boolean index I call is in, but I put a tilde in front. So this is like a reverse, right? So it's like calling, so it's a bit like saying this is in, the other is saying it's not in. Okay, so instead of saying it's not in, you actually put a tilde in front. So this is kind of like, I think in some situation, if you in programming example lah, so you've seen before when you compare, right, you do a double equal. Now to reverse a double equal, you put exclamation. So this tilde is a bit like putting an exclamation in front of this is in result. sorry, I'm gonna look for this thing called the 2D. Okay. Okay. Well, I'll try something. So, okay. The 2D symbol actually is not just used in pandas. Can use in anywhere as long as you're dealing with Boolean indexes. Okay. So I'm going to try. So what I mean by is it can be used anywhere. This can be used anywhere, not just a pandas thing. Okay, so okay, different. Okay, did I go through all the methods? Okay. Alright, so that's the end of combining data sets. Merge and it's in. Okay, so if you have downloaded the data, have you downloaded all the data set for pandas? Okay, so I think you can try the merging one. So there's some example here, like example. Okay, take a look at this one. Okay, this is student ID. Okay. If you look at, okay, so if you look at the downloaded data sets, just try this out. So there's this merge students female, merge student male, merge test scores. So you can try to do a merge with these few data. So the objective is to merge test scores with either of these data sets to come up with a data frame that has both the student data plus the test score. Try that out. You should also try to merge the male and female students together into one data frame. did I manage to get your merge student score? Okay, so first thing you need to do is actually to combine the male and female data frames. So in that case, you use the data frame append. Either way, like male or female appended. Then you can do the merge between the students to the test scores. Now, if your students is the left side, then you probably want to reference or set that student's table as a primary merge reference. So that anything that's found in the student should have got a test score. If the test, if the student ID exists in students but doesn't exist in test scores, then like maybe the student didn't attend the test, you will be assigned a missing value. So sometimes you're not very sure because if you're dealing with a lot of data, you can't eyeball everything. So this is one, what I will do is to check if there are any end values by doing a search for, by doing is now check here. Okay, so if you don't find any end values, it's good. So I don't need to do any filling out any missing values. Then it's good, this data is good for doing something like a histogram or distribution based on test scores. So you should get something like this if you print out the DF student score merged. So test score should be appended to right hand side. Okay. So now I'll move on to grouping of data. Okay. So grouping of data is a very common function, especially if you want to create some kind of categorization of the information. So in the case of the students one, that if you just merge it together, once you merge, you get one single data frame or table. In a way, you can do some grouping here. So grouping can be, in this case, one of the obvious group here will be by gender. Okay, you can actually group this data by gender or so. Okay, so any of the column that uses text as and has some kind of categorization, maybe it's like town, like HDB data you actually look at, there are like room types, the flat types, okay, or towns, or even the floor. So those can be valid town groups. So how do you group data if you're given a large set like this? Okay. So here are some of the functions group by. Of course, when group by, you need to specify the column to group by. Okay. Or index level. There's also from data frame, if you have groups, you can access the individual groups. Number of groups, size of the group, which is number of rows in each group, and aggregate function in the group. So aggregate function will be like your sum, mean, count, those kind of things. Okay, so this is a typical like large data set. So sometimes you get data set that they mash up everything together. And in this kind of data set, you can notice that there are some possible groups already. For example, nation here. The nation here can be a separate group by itself. Runout nation as well, like you can group by runout nation, group by nation, okay, or group by winners. So already you can see some natural groups happening. Okay, so if given that cell data and you want to, in this case, you want to rank nation by the number of championships you won. Okay. You can achieve this by using a group by function. So if this is the data I have, but the objective is to rank nation by the championship I won. So in terms of nation, there are multiple roles for each nation. Okay. How do I do that? So in terms of reading the data, which is this data set, I want to run the group by function to group by nation. Okay. So in that case, my nation group will have a size and can do a sorting value based on that size. Okay, I'm going to try out the grouping function on the student score data. So my obvious grouping here is actually by gender, because that's the other identifiable type of category column. Now if I have like other choices of category columns, could be by maybe by teacher. Same as a common few teachers along, or by school, okay, or by town, can do that too. So let's say I reuse this data to do a group. So DM student groups. So how do I use this? Basically, call the group by function is part of the data frame object. And so you need to send in a list of the columns you want to group by. In this case, I'm going to group by gender. And let's see what is in the group. Okay, so if you try to do a group by with results in the group and you print it out, it'll tell you this is a data frame group by. Okay, can't see any data, right? So let's try to take a look at this. Nations group. So group by give you this group. Nation wins. Group by size. Okay, let's try this. Sending a bit by put force. Okay, what happened? Let me pull this up. Let's see what's inside there. Okay. So when I group by gender, 529 female, 529 male, 464. What do you think the number comes from? Anyone want to guess where the number comes from? 529 and 464. Don't think that's the sum. Does anyone want to guess why is it that value? Okay. size, number of rows in each group. Okay. So group by size, so group by and I call size gives me the number of rows for each group. So saying that 529 rows for female, 462 for male. Something is wrong. Okay, I'm lost. Sorry. Okay, if group by is a group by size is supposed to give me number of items in each group. This doesn't make sense. Because if I have 1,006 students, this doesn't add up to 1,006. Right? Size is number of rows in each group. Like small m, big m. Yeah, doesn't make sense. Why does... See, let me find out what else can I get from group. Group by will give me groups, indices. Okay. Apply, aggregate, transform. Mean as well. Okay, so by right I can actually sizes. Ahem. Oh, check this out. I got missing values. Sorry, I got lost trying to explain to myself why these two numbers don't add up to 1006. Okay, reason why these two numbers don't add up to 1006 because I got missing values in the gender. No wonder. Okay, so when you're doing data, you get surprises like that. You'll be like, why does it not work? Okay, there are missing values. So obviously, me looking for missing values in test score is not good enough. Okay, so just now when we saw the slide have this function called isNow, right? But the way you use it is like a column. You choose a column and you apply isNow. So what should I do with this kind of data? What do you think you should do with this data here? Delete? Assume gender for them? Okay, so let's say you want to delete lah. Okay. If you do that thing where you don't care, right, just delete. So students. So before I even get to doing the merge to the scores, right? Can do drop an A. Come, I will come back to here again. Sorry, data. Drop an A. What's the location? Axis, how trash in place? Are in place. In place. Okay. Okay, now it makes sense. Okay, 529 plus 464 is 993, right? Okay. So I just blindly drop anything that's NA. Okay. Bad news for the student later, come and report they're missing. Okay. So strategy 1, just delete them. Strategy 2, replace the gender with an arbitrary value. Okay, so somewhere maybe they didn't fill out their gender or someone missed it out. Okay, so now it looks correct. So why is 529 and 464 when we do size is the number of rows in each group. Okay. So what did I do just now with head is that you can actually apply head to the groups to see a snapshot of each group data. So in this case it gives me by default five from each group. Okay, so that's why I see the first 5M and the first 5F here. Okay, getting size here probably doesn't mean anything. Okay, I'm probably not interested in the size, right? I'm more interested in the score mean, right? Or something like that. But that's roughly what you get with group by. So the example in the slides is referring to, I think, yeah, this is like the country that scored the most championships. So when they do a group by nation and then size, basically it just tells me there are 13 entries for Spain, 12 entries for Italy. Okay, so you rank them by the number of entries in this origin data. So every entry that's there typically means that they have a winner from the country. So the next example, if not just stopping there, you want to find out not by total win, but by country alone, but by club. So each country has clubs, right? Like in Spain, you have Real Madrid, Italy, one club. So some of the countries have more than one club. In this case, look at Italy, it has two clubs inside. Okay? So there is multi-column group by function that you can do. So in the group by function, it allows you to enter a list or dictionary or tuple of the columns you want to group by. So as you put in multiple columns, you do a multi-column grouping. Okay, then you then give you this kind of result. Now if I look at my student example here, I don't have that many columns to play around, okay? So I will probably look at another data source that I can play around with. Okay. So let's see. Do we have something like the grouped? Okay. I have no idea what this actually means. ARV count. Okay. So this is country. You can do a grouping on this example. So in this IVA1 group, you can actually do a group by region and then later do a multi-column group by region and then country, or whether they call it C or R in this case. Okay, so let's use this. So if I use this example to create a group, so df group. Was it IVA1? So if I read this file, this CSV file in as a data frame, and then I do a group by, go to df IVA1 group by. So I'm going to group by region. And then look at the sizes. And sort the values. Is it small or big? Small. Something. So, oops, keyword, region, doesn't exist. Oh, small. Okay. Nope. Sort values. Okay. So this is grouping by region. The number here basically sizes, which is number of rows from the data. So Asia itself has 432 entries, Europe has 216. Okay, so if you don't want to do multi-column, in the group by, you just need to specify the second column to group. In this case, I'll be doing by country, which is called COR. Then you get this data. So nice, number 36. Doesn't look right to me. Seriously, 36 or more. Okay, so apparently each country has 36 entries. Okay, so simple example of grouping multi-columns. Okay, is there anything I can do with grouping? So just exploring grouping a bit. If you look at grouping, okay, so size is one of the functions from group that gives you group by the size. Now, if you look at the group by documentation, you can actually see a lot more functions available here. Okay, so you can actually do a cumulative sum, mean as well, compute mean of groups, excluding missing values. Sum as well, okay. Okay, so if you're interested, you can look at the group by function and see maybe what you can use from here. This would be useful if you want to create a chart based on the groups. So if you get the count rows and you can do a chart based on the different groups you have. Right, next one we'll be looking at will be applying functions. Okay, so what does applying functions mean? So looking at this is apply for pandas. Okay. So if you have a series like this, some numbers, each of them represented by a country as an index. You define a function to Fahrenheit. Okay. So if all these numbers are degrees Celsius, you want to do a conversion to Fahrenheit, right? You can actually apply this and give you another date, give you a set of series based on the function itself. This is very similar to what your basic Python will do with lists. So when you remember in your NumPy arrays, right, you can actually apply direct calculation operations on the list. Like this case, I can do a plus on the item, right? So when you can actually do a more complicated way of applying values for each row for pandas in the series itself. So then we'll set up a series. And the index is, so if you create a normal typical series like this, and maybe I define a function. So this needs to have a value. So series okay. So here is, so if you have, let's say, data that you collected from somewhere, and you can actually choose to apply a function on the series itself. Okay. So it's useful in a slight example is, let's say you collect data from a country that gives you temperature in Celsius and you need to convert it to Fahrenheit, or the other way around, right? So for calculation's sake, you can do that. Especially for different standards of measurement, like in imperial standards and such. So if country will use miles, but you need to calculate in kilometers, you can apply functions to transform the values in the series in the columns. Now the example here is in series, so it's probably better if you do it in data frame. So this is for data frame. So in the data frame, you can also apply your values in to modify the values in data frame. Now this example actually modifies all the values in the data frame itself. Okay, so let's say this is my data frame before application. Every student has some kind of reward values. So my multiply here, which times 2, applies to all the values. I think your question would be, how can I do this for one column that I choose rather than all the columns? Because most of the time, you wouldn't do it all columns, right? Okay, so let me take a look at the apply function. So we're going to look at the apply function. Okay. What do you have? So apply can be from data frame or from the series. So the options in data frame here, function to apply to each column or row. Okay. So if you want to apply to a specific column, axis, default is 0. Apply function to each column. Or you specify 1 or columns, apply function to each row. Okay. Broadcast, raw, reduce, cell type. Let's try this. Okay. So I'm looking for apply a function to certain columns in data frame. See column X and Y only. Oh. Okay, you're using a lambda for this. Okay, if you want to apply your function to certain columns of data frame, you have to use a lambda notation. What is a lambda notation? Okay, your slide don't even cover lambda notation. Not really. A little bit only. Okay. So y'all have not seen a lambda notation, right? This lambda thing. Okay, so actually lambda notation is very powerful. It's actually something you will naturally use when you do deal more with pandas. Unfortunately, the slide only say lambda once here. by right, you all should learn the lambda notation. Okay. Let me just run through this based on my article. Okay, apply a lambda. You have applied, but you cannot lambda, so a bit handicapped. Okay, so this is typically how you would actually, okay, do you understand what this actually equation does? Okay, so what's happening here is that you have a data frame and you have a column called average rating. So you're taking the data frame, two columns to compute something, weighting and meta score. Okay, apply some computation, and then assign the values back into average weighting. Okay, so what this statement basically does is say for every row where there is a weighting and meta score, you will follow your calculation and then create a value based on this and assign it back to average weighting for that row. Okay, simple calculations like this can be done fairly easy. But let's say the author here talk about something more complicated, like you have to check. In this case, the data frame is about movies, and you want to calculate different type of rating based on the different genre of the movie. Like thriller will follow a certain calculation, comedy will be another calculation. How do you do that? if you try to follow the original example, try to do it on your example, then your statement will become longer and longer. So the original calculation here is meant to be very simple one-out calculation. There's no like if then else logic. Okay. To do the if then else logic, you normally need to create a function. So the idea with just now it applies that you create a function so you can apply it to your data frame. Now the problem with applying data frame, right, if you just use it like that, you apply to every row or column. So it doesn't care what column you want to work on. So in order to apply to only one or maybe your chosen columns, after you created a function, okay, which you're taking some parameters from the data frame, we use the apply with a lambda. So how does a lambda work is this. So we start with lambda telling Python this is a lambda notation. So x here, custom rating. So custom rating is the function, right? And what you do in custom rating, you pass in the two values. Okay, so the x colon here represents the row of the data frame. This is a bit like the, what do you call that? So the expressions, right? Your row expressions. So row expression, you remember we do a for x. For x in something list, and then you can apply different functions. So lambda is very similar to the aspect. So the x here actually refers to each row in the data frame. Okay, so for each row in the data frame, apply this function. Okay, and then each row you can actually extract out the column from x. So imagine x is the row, and you can actually refer to the individual column here and pass in the function. So the return value of custom rating, okay, will be sent back to this column itself, back to custom rating. So just now the example you saw where df apply, right, you don't actually assign any value back, right? So like just now when I did an apply on the series, okay, I assigned my value, but this is like the modified series. If let's say I would take maybe I take back the student example now, okay? I'm gonna do some transformation on the test score. So student scores, right? All is based on 100. I'm gonna convert them to based on 30%. So how would I do that is that I will maybe define a function called rebase score. Okay. So I want to rebase it to 30%. So I times the rebase score by 0.3. So if I were to do apply, okay, take my this. So if I were to just do apply like that, I think so. Yeah. Okay. Let's see what happened now. Because apply would do it for every row, right? Oh, just cute me. Can't multiply sequence by non-integer type float. Okay, why did this happen? Okay, so it's saying that I cannot multiply by non-integer. Type float, and yeah, index last name. Okay, last name is a string. You cannot apply, you cannot do a multiplication of string because it's a number. It's not a number, it's a string. Okay, so definitely it fails. So by doing an apply like that, it doesn't work. In fact, I need to apply only on a specific column. So I do this. So lambda x, right, in this case, now what I will do is I would say apply, okay. So this apply function will return me a series or array list of values, which I'm going to assign it back to the test scores. So rebase score, I'm going to pass in my actual score value. Okay, so imagine if x is the row, then I'll say, okay, I use my rebase score, pass x test score inside. Let's see how it's done. Okay, x is 1. And x is 1. Why x is 1? Because I think it's the column. It's a column. Oh, okay, I created a new column. Yeah. Hey. Oops. Yeah. Okay. So when I call apply, okay, instead of passing the just rebase score function, okay, that's the example. What I want to do is I only want to apply on test score. So I use the lambda notation to say, hey, for x, which is every row, apply this function or this function on this particular parameter. So I say call out this function for I pass in this parameter into the function. And x is 1 means it's column, okay? So 0 will be row, it modify for every row. So here I modify for the column. And then I will return that column that modified back into the original data frame test score. So now all the test score instead of based on 100 right now is rebased to 30%. So this will be if you want to like selectively modify a column based on the function, then you do this. You will come across the lambda more often after a while. Unfortunately, your slide only show one set of lambda. Okay. So here is more flexible because if your function actually can accept more than one parameter, so it means you can take different columns and apply and send to your function if you need to use them to calculate certain things. Okay, so the last example in the slide is when lambda thing comes out, okay? So this is a capitalization lambda function, means I uppercase all the names here, okay? So in this case, you can actually choose the column and do an apply as well. Try it out here. So let's say I don't do this. Simple example. Another way is to choose the column. Because I am specifying only one column, yeah. So this is another way. Okay, difference between the first one and second one is if your function only needs the column itself to transform the value, then you do this. But if your function needs to take another column of values, then you need to use the first method. Got it? Okay, take a break now. So after the break, we will go through, okay, you have a choice. I can either jump to SQL, which is topic 5. Or lab. Lab. Last question. Okay, lab. Let me do lab. So have a break, 15 minute break, then we come back and do lab. tell me to stop. The goodbye. Sorry. I'm out. Monday is public holiday.
What?
Yeah, Wednesday. Next Wednesday. We do Wednesday. Disappear. Okay, when you apply to the thing, you actually don't need a sign back. You can take away the sign back. Because when you choose a column to apply, right, the result is still need the columns. So you shouldn't assign it back here. You don't want to print the PDF, right? Yeah. So what you're doing here is that you choose the column to apply the capitalization function, right? Which you're gonna apply it.
Yeah, that's why. That's why I did that thing just now.
Then how come my one work? Unless you need assign back to the thing. Okay, wait, let me try again. Because based on this, you don't need to. Okay, let me run back here first, I run this one. Come back to here and run this. Oh, it doesn't. If you want to assign back, it's a funny one, it doesn't. You should do this. Hey, shit. Oof, okay, yeah. Okay. Maybe you're right, doesn't assign back. Unless you must do it this way. that. Then no choice to do this method. Because if I send this thing back to the test score, see what happens. Okay. I send it back to the column. You send it back to the column. So when you need to put df name equals df name dot by the calculation function. For my case here, right, in order to apply rebase the score, right, I need to pass in rebase and then pass in the x to the value. Because actually, when you say test score for every x, right, you're only getting this single value. Yeah, now it's rebasing.
I guess for like if the columns right, it applies all columns that we
don't
do like for this one.
Yeah, all columns. So we do apply, you will just run it on every column. The problem is that if some of the columns are actually text right, then you get an error message that you say text cannot be multiplied.
That's where we have to assign that to the specific column.
Yeah, so if you want to apply the same column, then you can say that column apply the function and then assign back to the column itself. You're there already, huh? Okay, am I still recording? Okay, still recording. Page 47. Who is at page 47? Are you all at page 47? I mean, task 1. Some more? Drop missing values with drop NA. Is everyone on this page? Okay. So, task is to drop missing values with drop NA. Load data from sync stat marital status into data frame, set index as first column, print the first 10 row easy. We should review column or row with missing metadata. Okay, not very true when you're printing your first 10 rows. Sometimes your data, your missing data can be somewhere in the middle one, so you don't see your first 10 row. So if you want to really find out if there are missing values, or rather you already have an approach. The approach is to drop right, then you just don't care, just drop any. Okay? But if your approach is to find out what is missing and fix it right, then you should write a bit of code to find out what is missing first, and then decide what to do. Okay, so this assumption is you will just drop whatever NA just drop. Okay, so use the panda drop NA to drop all the column with missing data from my DF. Key information column, not the row. Okay, when you are doing drop NA, just now what happened? You will drop the row, not drop the column. But this is asking you to drop the column. Okay, so if you just drop NA, right, the column, the row will disappear, which you don't actually want. Okay, the thing is because this data has, this data is inverted, but normal way this data should look like, if you're doing Excel, right, is your variables will be your column header, your years will be your rows. Okay, then if you do drop NA, it's very nice. But now because it's the other way around, pivoted, when you drop NA, you must drop the column. Okay. So in this case, 1981 and 1982 are dropped because they have a lot of NA. But in this case, I think the tolerance is there's one NA that you just drop the whole thing. So question is how to drop NA by the column, which means the axis. Okay? So axis default is 0, which is the row. So now you just find out if can you use axis as a parameter and drop NA to say I want to drop the columns only. Okay, so let's check out data frame. is it that? No, pandas, right? Pandas drop an A. Yep, online. Okay. Let me introduce you to an offline tool. So sometimes you all will be looking at laptop, there's no internet or wireless at C, right? Outside for some reason. I download this Wi-Fi called Zill. So Zill allows you to download your library, programming libraries, whatever you need. So you can actually pre-download Matplotlib, Pandas inside, even Python library. So in case you need an offline version to read, you can use this to read offline stuff. Okay. You can also do a search. So I want to look for drop NA. You may need to tell me which function you have. Okay. So I'm going to look at data frame drop NA. Okay. So in the data frame drop NA, it has an option called axis. So axis, whenever it's zero, it means drop the row. So now since you're going to drop the column, you should specify axis as 1. Then it will drop the column with an NA instead of the row. So for this example here, okay, please use the axis parameter to tell pandas to drop the column 1981 and 82. That's it. So let me try to do the same thing. Maybe this is what? Where's the data called? Oh, lab data must be download. Some data. Okay. Oh, is there any? Okay, sorry. Sync stats. This is. Oh. Okay. Battle status. So what we do? We should do. Okay. So my DF, you got my DF. Got drop A. Is the one. Okay, what happened here? Let me see your original data first. Okay. So when you need to look at the original data and see what it means by missing values. Okay, so remember just now I was showing you the option where you can say, oh, if it's this thing, it's an NA, right? So by default, pandas does not recognize a hyphen as an NA unless it's... So what was that? So read Excel. Okay. So read Excel will be similar to read CSV, hopefully, any values. Okay, so when you read in Excel or Python already has this set of predefined values that it knows the value in the column in Excel or CSV is a now missing value. Now your data for the marital status, the missing value is defined by a hyphen. it's not in any of this matching text. Means you tell Python any hyphen is considered a missing value. So we need to provide this parameter to read Excel function. That's why when you do drop any axis 1, this doesn't work, right? Still like that. So I'm gonna say any value is this. Try this. So now that I told Python, hey, the any value is a hyphen, okay, now in regards that stuff as hyphen, right, then I can finally do a drop NA. Which right now you notice the data 1981 and 1982 are missing, because those are missing values. No more, right? Original data, let me go here. So these two columns, because they are empty values and they have their own way of defining an end. And missing value, I need to tell Python what is that way. Then when I do a drop NA and then find the axis, then my 1981 and 82 will disappear. Now if you didn't use axis in your drop NA because axis is normally 0, and you try to do drop NA, what happens is that all your data will disappear. Okay, drop NA by default drops by the row. So if every row, a row contains even one NA value, the whole row will disappear. So if you do drop NA without specifying axis 1, you get this result. So in order to avoid that, specify your axis as 1 to say drop the column.
But you said that you print the first 10 rows, which already
okay. The first 10 row doesn't always review the column or row with missing data. Okay, so if you're really doing this as a job, right, don't rely on the first 10 row. Your missing data can appear anywhere in the data set. As a guide or exercise, because they tell you 10 rows because you can see it already. Because 10 rows is based on the variables. So because your database, this data itself, right, has this about 10 rows of data, so you can easily see the missing value. But if you're dealing with something in hundreds or thousands, right, there's no way you can do it. So if you're dealing with large data set, I will suggest you write some kind of function or procedure to count any values there. If you, let's say you want to handle it like fill it out with a zero, a default, or a mean. Okay? If your strategy, like I said mentioned before, is to just drop it, right, then you don't care about that counting part, just drop it.
So if it's a case that, for example, now if you want me to the dash with
the NA, yeah, so like I mentioned before, just now when I tried to do it without looking at origin data, I realized it didn't work. Drop NA was still showing me, after I drop NA, I still have 1981, 1982 with a dash. So what I had to do was to look at the data itself in Excel file. Now you can also do a print inside Python, yeah, to look at it. So because the data set is small, it's easy to figure out that all this is considered a missing value. Now in the real world, it can be a little bit more complicated because sometimes you get a data source from somewhere else and people don't actually give you the full story. So maybe in the real world, it will take a few rounds to figure out that you use this for empty value, you use that for empty value. Okay, so it's not so smooth sailing, okay, not all the time. So once you realize that, okay, all the missing values is always consistently a hyphen, okay, and someone didn't play punk by adding a hyphen and space, okay. I tell you, it'd be a joke, if halfway through, right, hyphen, 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 and then there got a hyphen space. Okay. So those are little problems that can really make your life a little bit terrible, okay. But thank God all of them are very simple one hyphen. So in the read Excel method or function, you need to specify what are the any values. This goes back to whenever you're using a function, right? If you're not very sure what it can do, refer to documentation because the slides don't cover all the options you can throw in the function because it's really too much to explain every one of them. So you need to go back to here and then look at, hey, you can actually, look, even the read Excel has so many options. So you will take a bit of you'll take your own time to really like understand somehow how some of this issue will help your work. And if you do know some more of these options, right, it will speed up your homework when doing data analysis. Okay. I think you can just do as what lah. Maybe the print out the first 10 row, you will see it here, it's quite standard lah. Okay, yeah. So you can, I think you follow is, okay, so follow the instruction in the lab, just print out the 10 rows, and then do draw NA and print out the result. But I'm telling you what, in the real world is different lah. Okay. What is the next one? Oh, no more idea.
It's okay. Can you just show how to how to fit the first 10 row? The next one. So what?
Actually, I'm very lazy. I'll use it, but the output that in the assignment in the lab looks like this, right? Actually, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Actually, there are 10 rows here already, lah. So you don't.
Actually, in the data set, it's about 15 rows.
15? Yeah. Is it easy? Oh, 15. Okay, sorry. Okay lah, then you must print first 10 rows, right? So you all remember your row subsetting? How do you subset a row? Something like that? So you do a row subsetting, print the 10 rows. By the way, you do get the slash thing, right? Okay, so that's called a false break. So Python sometimes decides that your screen is not big enough, then you will break the other columns in the next row. In order to circumvent their breaking, because you know, right now it looks like you break into three rows, okay? But anyway, your lab actually show only 1986. Why? Actually, there's more. Cause it never there's no specification here to say that you have to take only these 2 years. You get everything. Oh yeah, remember to also specify your index column. Index column is 0. Okay, so if you need to specify index column so that you don't have your natural index 0 to 10 coming out there, so you get this nice representation. Now, for those who want to get rid of this false break, right, where your star gets thrown to the next line, it's not much of an option because there's a lot of columns to display. There's this option called pdset, or this function from pandas called pdset option. Okay, and you need to specify the property to set pandas set option. Okay, so pandas set option is a global option, is a function in pandas to set certain options in pandas, which is a lot to do with how things are being displayed largely. So there's this parameter called display, followed by dot, followed by this sub parameters here. So I was reading one of the people on Stack Overflow was writing, how do you adjust your star so that it comes out in one row? That's assuming you really don't have that much things. Okay. So there was like this example where I set the column width to this, plus I also set the one more item, max columns. So set max columns to 0. Okay, so why is 0? It's because 0 means there's no max columns lah. And you mean by saying 0 doesn't mean that there are no columns. Yeah, so if you do that, then you'll get this relatively squashed up table. in which it cannot still, it still breaks into the next line because there's simply too many columns to display. Okay. Yeah. So it's like this is an example of, oh, there are like no missing values here. Okay, it's very obvious. So I should do a drop NA axis one, which is a column, and then print the filtered one, which is below, which is here. Okay. Can be very messy though. If you want to follow the example strictly, I don't think they specified the years. Unless it's a continuation from A lah, where they say years is there. Chino. So if you're going to use the actual data and your data turns out looking like this, I'm okay. I can accept because you've got so, the data has so many columns.
But you see the left four, right? You see the picture, you see that it's remaining data set after dropping columns. But the thing is like...
The blue one is before I drop the column.
Yeah, the green one.
Then the green one is after. Yeah. Yeah, as long as the key thing is based on what I'm looking at the data, 1981 and 1982 should not exist after you drop it, which is this is the section, right? So it's missing already. So this is acceptable for me to so sure you know how to drop the columns. Any other questions on the lab? Yes. All the years, huh? Well, the lab didn't exactly specify which years should be displayed, although they only showed anything that's between 1980 to 1986. Yeah, so I think the lab, like, the picture here kind of like cheat a bit lah. If you're going to filter off and show me it's removed, right, I'm good with that also. So if you want to like filter, right, say you don't like it to overflow to the next line, because there's so many years, right? Then you might as well do a ILOG log. Sample out what the years you want. 1980 to maybe 1987. Okay lah, but yeah. So maybe I do this kind of thing here. A node. Shit, what am I missing? Suppose to choose by. I want to retrieve the cons. Retrieve this one, this two. So if you were to do something like that, so this is like, oh, the first one, 1980 to 1987, with the two missing columns, then after that I drop it, then I get, or you can play shit by, you know, you don't, play shit by printing out the sample size of it. So we're gonna play cheap by doing that, right? So that my presentation, so your presentation is nicer looking. So I'll do this lah. So whenever I print out, then I will always jump the year inside. Okay, shit. Remember to use the log. slice going on? Cannot slice, where is the nexus? First 10. See? Yeah. Sergeant Razor data got repeat. Never mind, okay, that is the data. The data has repeated rows. Very weird. Wait. Can't do size indexing or index release indexes. Oh, okay. Because I set the index as variable, so I can't do that. Shit. Data frame. I want to choose the first 10 rows, but because my index now is not numbers, should be I log. I log is pure integer based for section by position. By right, I should be using I log. Okay, then I will show the first 9. Yeah. Okay, that's 8. Okay, so you want a very nice presentation based on the Word document. When you print out the data, right, then you use ILOG to say I want the first 10 row. And the first 8 columns. Okay, then you show, then you can see the null value. Then after you drop it, then you can do a log to say I want the first 10 row, 1980, 1987. Or use ILOG. ILOG is when you want to refer just by the index. Okay, then log is you can use a label. If you want to present like the way the Word document shows you. So this is like sampling lah, just snapshot of part of the thing, not the whole, not everything. Actually, I look at the data, the original data is very weird because some of the rows are repeated. Actually, they are repeated. Single, married, widow, divorce, male. Single, married, widow. Oh, okay. Y'all know why the data is repeated? You know, there's no reason why marriage should appear 3 times. Correct? Because this bunch is under total. The next bunch, single to this, is under male, group under male. And the next bunch is group under female. or different numbers, so there's some aggregate going on, like total females is this, and then among females is that breakdown. I'm guessing? Total will be all this added up together. Should it be total? By right, should be total. So total is this one here. Yeah. Then male should be then 2 here. Problem is the data. Yeah, right. Yeah. So the grouping. So actually, this data is also good for doing genome. If you use this data properly, right, actually you have to take out some of the rows. If you want to do a proper chart on this, right, you want to take out some of the rows. Okay. Drop the row. you should do subsetting. Subsetting to retrieve the color, the rows that you want. So let's say you're going to draw a chart for this, right? You're going to do map, plot a graph of this thing. You have to decide, hey, I'm going to plot, I will throw away the total. Let's say I'm going to plot based on, regardless of gender, then I will choose these 4 rows. And then if I want to break down that into the 2 genders, right? I will maybe do a group bar chart on this one, and then this another group. Okay, so when you get data, sometimes just don't take it at face level lah. Because sometimes, like this example, they have a total, they have the total male, total female. Okay, but it's not visible in Excel because all looks flat. Okay. So if you're going to be a data analyst, whenever you get data, right, question everything inside. Like, why is it repeating? Why is it like this? Why is it like that? Okay, any more question on the last lab task? So next lesson will be on SQL.
So we need to download SQL and Python.
Okay, lie, we got a bit of time, so let me look at SQL.
One of the whatever things that you need to have what SQL from Microsoft is Windows is 5.7. So just go
anyhow. 5.7, we're already.
That's what they say, yeah. So what version should we download?
Doesn't matter, download the latest one.
So we just go to my SQL and download that?
Yep. I'm not sure the link still works to 5.7 version. It's okay to download the latest, which is version 8. Not much difference. The principles are the underlying principles for using it are the same. So just download the latest one.
So we will download
it in class. Yes. So please download your MySQL. Okay, download. So when you download MySQL, right? This is the first time you've seen it your life. Okay. So MySQL, the modern one, comes with a thing called the installer. Okay, so there are 2 components for database that you need to, maybe 3. 2 components that you need to interact with. First component you install is the so-called the server. The database server. Okay. Second thing you need to install is the workbench. Okay. So the server, when we say servers, is almost like an invisible piece of software sitting on the computer and there's no GUI, there's no user interface. So the only way to interact with it is you have a user interface GUI kit or tool. In this case, for MySQL, they call it the workbench. Now, when you go to MySQL download, you will come to this nice page that says download and installer. I will suggest you use this installer, which is 8.0.19. Okay. either one version doesn't matter, it's just the bigger 300 megabyte contains everything, so you should get it there. So when you download this installer and run it, either one, 300 meg just makes it easier for you to install stuff because it's like preloaded. So the installer when you launch it looks a bit like this. So you download first time, you will not have much, okay? So if you've not been doing any database related stuff, it should be empty here. Then you need to click on the add button, okay, to choose what you want to download. So two things you need for the class is firstly the MySQL 8 server. So under servers, you need to expand and choose one of the options that fits your computer system. Okay, second one will be the application, this thing called the MySQL Workbench. Take the latest version and then click the arrow to move it to the right hand side. So the right hand side should have two things. One is the server, the other is called the Workbench. And then you click next. Along the way, if your Windows system asks you to install some Microsoft stuff, just go ahead and say yes, install it. Okay, you need it. Mac users might think it may be a bit simpler. You drag to your applications folder for two things, the SQL Server and the Workbench. You are done. So we will use the Workbench to run your SQL queries. Okay? Yeah, we were like, okay, how to connect? Okay, that's the... This is the command line version of doing it. Once you install the MySQL server in Windows, it will automatically run on its own actually, so you don't need to run that exe file. Okay. The rest of the stuff here, we will run all this inside MySQL Workbench. Let's see what the methods. After that, you install another thing called MongoDB. Yes. Okay, there are a total of three software to install. Firstly is MySQL Server, second for your convenience, MySQL Workbench, number three, MongoDB Server. Three things to install, download and install. How you access it will be either the Workbench or through Python code in your pandas. And that's the end for today. Happy New Year. 恭喜发财.
万事如意.
Mm.